Кто еще не забыл, мы сегодня...
All right, if you still remember, we are talking about Linux today, and we will speak now about network interfaces. Pavel and Denis will be our speakers. Okay, good day. My name is Pavel Kurochkin. My name is Denis Gabidullin. We work as STC Metrotek, and we will speak about Metrotek and networking controllers based on FPG. And we will speak about how we use Linux for that. So this is the plan of our presentation. We will first speak about the FPGA. Imagine that your network controller no longer satisfies you, not the appropriate offload, and some other problems, and you decide to design your own network controller. What you need to put it into operation in Linux. In order to speak about that, we first cover architecture, show block diagram of network controllers, how they're structured based on what we produce, and then we move over to driver part. We need to speak about structure of the driver, which parts are there, which we take from Linux kernel to make it operational. Why we decided to do this topic? We have 12-year experience of developing, designing networking devices, and they all use Ethernet from 1 gigabit to 100 gigabit is in our line of devices. Many of those devices have network controllers embedded and network drivers. Not all drivers are working on Linux, but last 5 years we use it mostly. And we mostly use now Linux for our hardware, so we have certain experience, and that is why we decided to share that with you. As a picture here, we show two of our devices. On the left is a mobile and compact device, which has 2 gigabit capacity. The FPGA is smaller, and 2 gigabit. Networking interfaces in Linux. On the right, you can see a monster, which is a B100, and it's 100 gigabit Ethernet, 40 gigabit Ethernet, and 10 times 10 gigabit. This is in current manufacture. 100 gigabit is the main one, networking interface. We also have a project that those 10 gigabit parts would also become full-fledged network interfaces. It would then be possible to use it as a sort of commuting device, as SDM switchboard. Why FPGA? What is that? Briefly. This is a matrix with a hundreds and thousands elements, and each element can be used as trigger of logic function or whatever. Advantages of FPGA compared to ready off-shelf controllers. That is flexible, more flexible if you need to program, to adjust something, and to provide support to kernel if a device is out of operation and then shows up again. You want to know what is happening. FPGA has certain advantages. High performance FPGA. If you compare with others, it allows to resolve more tasks per second. And FPGA allows a maximum or optimum correlation between the various parameters of efficiency. Ready crystals, or ASICs, we call them, is the switchboarding. Other companies, they also switch to FPGA, but they say it's more expensive, but it provides additional flexibility if it is important for you. Also, it allows to filter additional traffic and some other options. So one nuance is how to teach the system so this device would disappear and then show up again. Tomorrow we will have another presentation, Device 3 Plus Overlay, that will help you understand that aspect. And now we can go over to the abstract architecture of a network controller, NIC, and this is a basic architecture. We start with transceiver. We connect by copper or optic wire. If it's optic, it should be also a converter for signal. And then there is an external modulation unit. Then interface supplies a signal to MUC. And then in that block, our FPGA works. MUC has a task of converting to internal interface signals. And the most interesting part is when you design your own network containers, application logic. And for that purpose, you do that. If you don't need that logic, specific logic, then you can buy off-shelf controller and install that. If you need some more flexibility, filtering or some other offload that others cannot provide off the shelf, then this part becomes important for us. And then we come to interface. Despite an offload, despite that being a network device, you need to switch all the packages that you work with to Linux, and then interface that we use for that, PCI Express, that we see more and more often in real life. And above that all, we have a network driver, which does input-output interface and manages all the layers below that. I would add a little bit, those blocks, as a rule, are inside the box, or on the board. An object transceiver, SFP, SFP plus, CFP, and other similar devices, they are part of the card inserted in the box. And also, interfaces are shown in red, the bottom. Those interfaces do not support line read. Using specification, you cannot just receive every second packet and send it to MAC. That would not work. That means 100-bit Ethernet you support. Here you could process as much as you like. You have time enough. And still it'll be Ethernet, 100-bit Ethernet. But it could be more capability embedded into that using the code. Now let us consider an example. We have four examples in total. Gigabit Ethernet, 10 gigabit and 100 gigabit. You'll see that there is a lot of similarities, but also differences. In gigabit Ethernet, I have an example based on system chip, which we described last time. This is a micro scheme where processors in single crystal, they can transfer packages between themselves through the common memory. Very wide bandwidths, it's enough. In this implementation of the scheme, transceiver responsible for gigabit Ethernet for codium that is outside this crystal, and we have gigabit connection, HDMI interface. And in this case, we support a possibility of connecting an optical transceiver and also a usual RG45 connection. When we get it off the shelf as a ready box, it is one thing. But if we develop our own, we have to also manage SFP and some other elements. And we need to manage the file itself. We would demonstrate that using examples later on. Next example of architecture is the same socket, but 10 gigabit Ethernet. Differences are not that many, but interface between MAC and FEE is changing, is replaced with different one. XFI is different, and 70 or something pins. It is feasible to use XAUI, preferable. In this case, we don't have to do low cost FPGA. Here we go to middle range, which should include some transceivers also. A second gigabit arm and gigabit would process it all, and gigabit would not be available at the bottom of the device, just the input capacity. But this is quite the difficult task. This conference is about Linux. We'll go over to Linux soon. Those architectures are similar to a great extent. We just wanted to describe that in general before we go to Linux. And the second is a 10G solution, PCI Express-based solution. We go over to a new platform with that, many ports there, and we have taken top FPG, which allowed us to connect several 10G and 100G Ethernet. And as a result, the system on the chip of that type is a new one. Didn't exist before. It's like a comparable with PC, and we can use it to PCI Express. DMA socket, the same, but it'll be, from the hardware point of view, a different interface. And the rest is the same. X5 goes to PGS, and we work with FI differently as a result. One more difference is that transceivers now have to support 10 gigabit, because SFI, XFI is, requires that. We go to top FPGA. The next slide will be an example from real life. That's a big device that we showed on the first slide. So we have two slides here showing that, but it is actually a single box that we are talking about. When we connect 100 gigabit in the transceiver level, MAC FPGA, and the rest is similar in structure, and it is not a secret. This is a limitation of the hardware platform. 100 goes in, 2 by 16, 64 gigabit maximum that can be that can transfer. Any acceleration is difficult. 240 gigabit, nobody even requests that, because it will be overload, definitely. So we finished with architecture, with the hardware. We go to kernel now, to Linux. And what we need to do for this device to really become network controller. We have hardware, we have designed that, we have manufactured the board, the firmware for that, everything is ready. And now we need to transfer packages from process to FPGA. We'll have to do that. For that, we would use this subsystem, which is called NAPI. And there'll be interruptions, of course, because package would arrive, and we need to know about that immediately. And we also need to manage, with the help of fconfig, tool for this network interface. We need to install some additional elements to advertise some modes, not gigabit, but 110 gigabit, for example. We need to know whether the link is up or not. And this is seen from a file. And you need to pull your registers to find out that. We want to do that as part of our system, so that you don't need to rewrite it and invent a bicycle every time you have to do that. We start by transferring the data. Actually, we receive the packages of data. That comes, data comes as packages. And a few words about the reception. Transfer is then mirror-like in the opposite direction. So if we imagine that from FPGA we need to take the packages and to deliver it to driver. One of the evident solutions, when we just open up the code of the kernel, think about what we have to do, is that we just do processor of the interruptions, and we do generation of interruptions, FPGA, and we get these interruptions and then transfer that to network stack. And that will work. That will work. We have 100,000, 10,000 packages per second. That will work. But let us imagine how in reality we'll have packages. Even for 1 gigabit, 65-bit, it is less than 1.5 million packages per second. With 10 is 15 million.
And we know that it's rather a costly operation of disruption of processing on such a blue-collar option. The entire processor time will be used for processing of disruption. This overhead will make it over costly. So disruption per se, breaking is not very interesting for us. Yes, but there could be something else here, another case when we're not using breaking. We don't use breaker here, so otherwise we'll have to ask FPGA whether it's ready to transmit packets for us. It's only good in several cases. If we know that we have got lots of packets, we can read them out of FIFO or some shared memory domain. But if there are no packets and we periodically ask FPGA, we either should do it very rapidly and react right away, or we download the kernel without packets. So then there will be a lot of time for the response when the packets are already arriving and arriving, and we did record them. And there are some cases when they are used, some cases when they are not. Next case, which is the method which is really used. It has been around for 10 or 15 years. It's called NOPI. Why such a bizarre name? Because in one of the fundamental books so for developers, the authors are saying that those guys who thought about it, they know how to come up with good systems and technologies, but not good names. NAPI, enigmatic NAPI, is decoded as no IP. It's a combination of the two previous systems. First, it's breaking in FPGA, and there is a processor which is ready to be called. We are waiting for the first packet. First packet arrives in FPGA, recorded it as DDN into system memory, and then the developer is called upon, but instead of giving up to the network, to the upper stack, after processing, we ask our network subsystem, the network stack, for it to include NAPI system, and we transfer our callback, after which the NAPI is a switched on subsystem. Requests software use. Each callback is followed by the budget, how many packets we could process at one go, so that that driver who was lucky to have controller receiving very rapidly, each callback for them is limited. And every time when our callback knows that there are some other packets in the queue for FPGA, so the breakers are not back on. As soon as it sees that there are no more packets, it informs the network subsystem that it does need calling and switches back to the breaking system. That is, the system gets back to its initial state. That way, the throughput capacity is increased drastically. We didn't show different codes here to illustrate this example. In the end of my presentation, there is a link whereby we use that NAPI. You can use that information. Now, how to manage the file to get the network information about the link and what's in the kernel for PFI managing. In the architecture pictures before FI, there is some interface wires or MDUs for wire interface or internal interface in FPGA. Sometimes the files in FPGA are in getting together, so it's MDU control interface, which doesn't have a 4-bit bus, but all the files are developed based on the recommendation, which is shown here. And there is just a handful of providers like Marvel Bit Computester. Previously, we were writing down the support and follow-up on our own, but there is now in the kernel, there is a set for several codebacks, read, write, reset, link handle. That will be enough. When Pavel says previously, it's when we didn't use the Linux FPC. If there is no NADOS support or in RTOs, you write down the pages of communications with Marvel on your own. Now life is much simpler for us to work with transceiver. Actually, there should be just monitoring done, and that will be that. To launch it, it's enough to have very primitive MDU controller and FPGA, rather two of those. And this is very simple. It's a small controller which receives queries from the driver and creates a transaction on this bus. As to the driver, it's just few basic things needed. If you need initiation callbacks for reading the entries for FPGA specific registers and callbacks when they find out that something changed in the connection, duplex speed or whatever. HA framework is very simple. It's very primitive FSM with a set of drivers. There is the abstract driver which supports only basic things, K82.3A. And so the communication goes in the following way. We indicate three callbacks. We are going that we are registering MDL bus, and then we ask framework, find us a specific one, or we say, like we're saying here, find us any transceiver which is present on this MDA bus, not on MDA, but on this. We know that it's there, but actually we should find it. Sometimes, when something goes wrong with the hardware, we cannot find it, even if it's sitting there. The transceiver has got lots of SQL addresses. It runs through these addresses and sees the vendors for this product. So it figures out what's the transceiver, and he sees if they're the private proprietary driver there. It uses the one like Marvel or the abstract drive, after which our final automatic drive is started. This is very primitive. Once in every 1 or 2 seconds, it does the calling of the link state. When something changes, it informs us about it. It pushes our callback for number 4, which is shown here. There is another call, and we transmit them. It's link handle, yes. And if we are going to get some new settings from a store and use them, they are not just going directly to read, write, and to transceiver, but to get on to this libfi, and libfi will do it internally and will continue monitoring. That's very basic thing, very straightforward, but very convenient. Next one, what we plan to tell you about is how to provide the access to basic functions of controller via S-tool. I think most of you used S-tool. This is a convenient utility for some features to balance on the kernels, for example. on the speed duplex and so on. Everything is ready for that as well in the kernel, and it's necessary to fill out the special callback table for each feature, managing S2 to do all the groundwork. That's the way it looks like. You fill out this structure, this table in which you transmit callbacks for each of the function, each one of the functions. For example, how to get via S2 the information about SFPU, which is connected to a system. We have got this SFPU here, so for that we may use such a callback, EEPROM module. EEPROM content from SRP is transmitted to this framework, and further on, S2 shows the spreadsheet, which is easily readable. We get it out of the box. That's the example is how to this module looks like. It's get module E prompt. There are two readings in SSP. The memory is split into two parts. Major one is extended. Maybe it's not so very important here. We have this story about very basic things, very initial level of the NIC driver, so we didn't get down into optimization, but actually we would like to give a word of caution for those who are going to write down the NIC for production or diversion. Think twice before you do it. Think about architecture, because about 4 years ago when we were making the first driver, we were making it with FC Express, and we already had DMA controller in FPGA, but all the other configuration, it was in CPU. The information, how many packets were received, how many descriptors were released. So all those transactions were generated to CPU, and we saw that that data is transmitted. When we looked at the throughput, it's 1500 byte packets. It was less than gigabyte. It was 500 gigabits, and we thought about it. We decided to calculate the number of transactions we have. In this very simple use case, when we receive one packet, bring it to the user space and transmit it again, there were six read transactions on Express and three write transactions. And let's see, on a PCM gray express, it was 400 nanoseconds downtime. Our nanoprocess, if it's just reading, that makes 500,000 transactions of read. If we have six, that will mean 80,000 packets. That's our maximum. And it's a far cry from the ideal 15 million. It took us 1 week. We removed all the read transactions, removed only two write transactions. CPU makes them in the amount of 15 million. That increased our threshold up to 6 or 7 million packets. And there were some trembles to get it out, squeeze it out from DMAP, and there were lots of very interesting things which could be optimized, but it's not about it now. It's about getting the general idea that if you have got a PC Express read transaction is way more expensive than write transaction, and nothing should be done on behalf of CPU. It's better to do it in FPGA and TMA, then you'll increase your throughput and you'll lose some of the downtimes along the way. Let's summarize on what we told you about. We've provided you with several examples of NIC architecture we use here with us. They could be very useful for you, and we looked at different components to be implemented in our driver in order to make this network interface which would be usable, and we described several frameworks which we're using for that, and we considered several case studies. Thank you. Questions? Could you expand on what should be done for the packets to be transmitted to CPU cache right away, this DSA technology? Well, in point of fact, we are not using any of this technology, although there might be some people in the hall who might answer this one. Thank you very much. We are focused on other things. Mostly we were focused on the hardware and the follow-up and support. We are talking about NAPI. This is the basic follow-up. This is the very beginning of the development. You are seeing that 100 gigabit on full duplex will not be transmitted to CPU. That means that the main work, the major work is done inside FPGA from within. We're talking about our device. It's goal. It's different. It's not 100 gigabit. Which class of algorithm are implemented in FPGA? What kind of router or whatever? One of the projects, one of the options is the balancer. When the traffic arrives, it's parsed and analyzed, and then there is the use of filter parsing the subject headings and so on. To what level? To level 4. I don't remember how many strings we have in the production. So right now it's only up to L4, and following these rules, it's switched to one or several dozens, and at the same time it's balancing if the rate of one flow that's was there. Higher than dozens, you may indicate N, and it will be equalized and balanced. So using this, the speed of oncoming packets is very fast, and very rapid, yes. Do you put memory next to it? Is it possible to have router? Yes, we do have memory next to it. We're very fond of the internal memory, although life prompts us that we should get onto the external memory. Internal is very convenient. As to the router, we're in the research. We're thinking about it. PGP should get on there, and we'll learn how to route in the best possible way. Thank you very much. Very interesting presentation. Tell us more about FFPGA on a Linux conference. The topic was discussed. Into Bottle Terra and extriver in PGL is a provocative question. Why not Intel when the speed is high? Why not Intel in future? That's my question. Well, I don't see any other alternative. I didn't quite understand your question. Well, I mean, now you're implementing this one. Why don't you get in touch with Intel? Because in future they'll have SSL Terra. So I think it's sitting on interconnect. It's slightly different from what you have in what you have it in Mac. Well, I did mention this Express PC here. It's Core 7 Intel, but that's FPC Express in case of that chip you're talking about. Interconnect will be much more powerful. Those slides when there is a 10 gigabyte, for example, yes, this is one decision. They are small and mobile. As to the one for several dozens, it's Intel Core 7, it's double core and mobile. It's mobile, but it's not 100 S2S Express. Now, in the current hardware version, it will not there because the threshold is on 64 gigabit. But we are thinking about the second revision, the retrofitting of that hardware. I'm a bit concerned about Intel with FPGA in one package. And because the idea is that Intel strives to impose an open cell at the end of the day. It's a bit disconcerting for me because and I didn't find the information whereby they say will provide you with that in FPGA, but they're planning to provide us with the interface you write on OpenXL. Then there will be kernels, which will be different. That's rather for those volumetric computations. For those who would like to write for FPGA but don't know how to do that as yet, the overheads could be high yet, and C is close to C. It's almost like a subset of the set. For software engineers, it will be convenient. For those who know how to write FPGA on system DLog, it's not so important to get onto OpenXL, so it would be great if Intel retains this opportunity for this end package directly. It will give us more leeway, more flexibility to squeeze it out from FPGA. And for long, it's possible to do everything, but not on OpenXL. But maybe in future, they'll improve their compilators, then we'll switch to OpenXL. One more question about Vice Stream, but maybe we'll discuss it on the sidelines of the conference. But there will be the presentation about it tomorrow.
All right, thank you very much. In answering previous question, you also answered my question that I wanted to ask about FPGA, how this complex functionality is implemented and balancing globally. There are two options possible how to do that. The system Verilog can be software written for that, which should handle that. That is what we did. It's not a software, actually, but a description of the scheme. And a second option is FPGA, several processors of general purpose to install, and usual program run on them. Yes, a soft processor, it exists, but the productivity of that is much lower. The task that we do, we have line read, direct, each package, independent conditions, has to be processed. Soft process is not an option for that. When you calculate the price of the solution, you would probably not agree to pay that high price. This is just for very specific applications, when it makes sense temporarily, but as not as a main part of the system. Thank you. Thank you for your presentation. A few questions I have about software. As far as I managed to understand it, you did PCI card with several ports that allows to work very fast in your system. Yes, for our system it looks like that. But then do you consider a DPDK for yourself, Data Plane Development Kit? Yes, we know what it is. I worked with that and was impressed quite much. The question is whether your system, a PCI networking card, can do offload, download of their hash, defining queues as done for networking card. Oh, okay, the question. We understood GPDK we answered too, but we did it for research purposes only, not as a main production. And that is why this is currently suspended. It's not implemented in our production board. The delivery packages to Linux, we didn't have a task to use maximum capacity to deliver. We use commutation between ports, and those packages are not going outside PGA. They remain there inside. So we speak about device that we developed for 100G. Network driver main purpose is to filter, using certain conditions to filter packages and look at those filtered, and then adjust filters. In presentation, use the word filtration or analysis. Speak of deep package inspection. FPGA, it's difficult to do. And here, a processor of general purpose would be appropriate if you upload it efficiently. Well, this is, we can do adjustment filter. It's not deep, it's only to level 4. filtering of packages. We have other devices where 10 is done. It's a different process. But you correctly in saying that part as usually is used is CPU, and they then think about some sort of acceleration. We go from PGA. Everything is on PGA. Now we try to use accelerator from that point of view. And that is what we are thinking about currently. I don't know about PCI Express. Should we speak on it? OK. And one more question. You mentioned Migrel. Chips, Migrel, they do precision time protocol and some other tasty things. Can your system do that? Yes, we in all our devices implement that too. Thank you. We do time stamping of our packages so that system knows where the package was delivered, dispatched. Thank you very much. I have two questions. First of all, a little bit more. Could you elaborate about strategy of exchange of information between Princex and 100, about 10 and 100? And also, second, you mentioned the DPI products that you have. Did you consider off-scale solutions as hardware top lines implementing hardware? Well, answering your second question, very often, when this is a business niche, clients come to us not satisfied for current hardware. They say that this and that is available in the hardware, hundreds and hundreds of rules, but not this element. And I would like to have it. We say we can support the same rules plus what you need additional. We need to expand the protocol. That is the answer to your question. The first question was about strategy of exchange, about PCA and host, host and processor, FPGA. You were bragging so much about your architecture, and could you a little bit elaborate on that exchange? Well, in our excellent architecture, we use DMA for that, and packages that are received at FPGA, they are recorded in the memory, written in the memory. Well, that is clear, but a bit more in detail. Well, I don't know why we're bragging about our architecture. I accented attention at the fact that this is basic architecture. We just mentioned how it is structured, nothing specific about that. But if you specify more what you're interested to, taking the challenges into consideration that you faced to process that many packages, what was successful, what was not successful, which bottlenecks you had, and it's difficult to predict. Well, we didn't have a goal to use B100 for do the 10 gigabit, 100 gigabit to the maximum. Maybe we should discuss it on the sidelines of this forum later on. Thank you. Let us thank our speakers.